Yes, I'm going to walk. Oh, that milky white way. Oh, child, some of these days. Well, I'm going to walk that milky white way. Oh, some of these days. Well, 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 I'm going to walk up and take up my stand. Gonna join that Christian band. I'm going to walk, whoa, that milky white way. Oh, Lord, some of these days. I'm gonna tell my, oh, my mother, howdy, 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 when I get home. Yes, I'm going to tell my mother howdy when I get home. Well, 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 I want to tell my mother hey when I shake mother hand that day. That's when I walk.
The Spirit of God confirms to our spirit that we are God's children. and if children being heirs, heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ, but we must share his suffering if we are also to share his glory. For I reckon that the suffering we now endure bear no comparison with the glory as yet unrevealed, which is in store for us. The created universe is waiting with eager expectation for God's Son to be revealed. Going down to verse 24. It was with this hope that we were saved. Now to see something is no longer to hope. Why hope for what is already seen? But if we hope for something we do not see yet, then we look forward to it. Going down to verse 36. We are being done to death for your sake all day long. And yet through it all, overwhelming victory is ours. Through him who loved us. For I'm convinced that there is nothing in death or life, in the realm of the spirit of superhuman power, in the realm of spirit of superhuman power, let us listen to this verse. In this world as it is, or the world as it shall be, in heights or depth, nothing in all creation can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Thank you.
thing that many of us are a part of. We come at this time to celebrate. Yes, we do shed tears. Yes, we do mourn. But our mourning and our tears are not without hope. Because those of us who know Christ Jesus Amen. Know that this is not the end. Amen. In fact, it's really just the beginning. Amen. Because we have hope and eternal hope. We have printed for us an order of service. We will follow it as printed. Please, please, as you sit and listen, ask the Holy Spirit to speak to you, to calm you, to give you the sense that you are in a place where prayers have been sent up, promises have been fulfilled, and God is in charge. We will follow the program as printed.
Let me pray. Father God, we come now to you.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
The gift of life.
Mm-hmm.
Given to this Lord.
Yes.
One that was a son. One that was a brother.
Yes.
One that's been a father. We thank you, Father, for every blessing that he's been to his mother, to his brother, and to his children. Yes. And we bow down, Lord, realizing that your will has been done. But we are left behind, Father.
Yes.
With the memories, the care. So I pray now, Father, for his loved ones,
yes,
the most
dear yes.
to him, his mother, his brother, his children. And I ask you now, Father, to comfort them in these times, Lord.
Yes.
Even right now in this moment.
Uh-huh.
But Father, days gonna follow, Lord. When they gonna look.
Uh-huh.
He's not going to be
there. Yes.
So I pray no time, Father, when their hearts were filled with sorrow.
Yes.
That you will comfort and strengthen them, Lord. For Father, we already have a testimony that we have hope.
Yes, we do.
So I pray, Father, let that hope spring up in them eternally, Lord. That they remember that he's now in your hands.
Yes.
And we too, Father, one day. We going to be in your hands,
yes.
Lord, in your eternal hands.
Yes.
But right now, Father, we need you to continue to hold us in the hall of your hands,
yes.
Lord. We pray that now, Father, by your power that you will just touch this
touch
family.
Lord.
Help them to endure. And then, Lord, one day, we too.
Yes, Lord.
Be the ones that will be the care of our family's homes. We pray, Father, that we have lived our lives pleasing enough in your sight. That we too may have the great hope, Lord.
Mm-hmm.
The hearing your welcoming voice.
Yes, yes.
We pray now, Father, for the one who's going to stand before us. We ask you now, Father, to strengthen her, Lord.
Yes.
Father, give her the words in your will to say.
Yes.
That it will edify our hearts right now, Lord. That it will build us up right now,
yes.
Lord. That when that day comes, we'll be able to hear your welcoming voice.
Yes.
And we ask that you appoint our souls for a resting place. Somewhere in your kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
All these blessings we ask now, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
To you and us all. God closes doors that no man can open.
Mm-hmm.
But listen to this. God opened doors that no man
yes.
can close. Amen. The door has been closed today. God for the life and legacy, young McWhite, relative of mine. Didn't know him, but he's in the Whitehead family.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Job in the Old Testament, I think he best described it. He said, "For I know that my Redeemer lives."
Yes, yes.
"And that he shall stand in the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin were destroyed this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself.
Yes, yes.
Mine eyes shall behold him, and not another." From the New Testament, very words of Jesus out of the book of John, he said, "I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die." So said our Lord and Savior.
Yes. Precious words.
Thank you. departed this life peacefully with loved ones at his bedside at Hartford Hospital on January 9th, 2024. He was born on March 17th, 1970, and throughout his life, he touched the heart of many with his warmth and generosity. A man of faith, Arthur gave his life to Christ at an early age and lived by the principle of helping others along the way. Arthur was a devoted veteran for 4 years and then was honorably discharged. He dedicated his time to various charitable causes, especially working with kids, including those with autism, participating in Special Olympics, and supporting foster kids and parents. Arthur's selfless nature extended to his involvement with the Manchester Community Response Team. A multi-talent individual, Arthur excelled in both sports and the arts. He played football at UConn and Northwest Catholic High School, as well as for the semi-pro teams Hartford Crusaders. Off the field, he was still a force to be reckoned with, achieving an impressive 290 points in a single season with the American Bowling Congress. In addition, he was an avid billiard player and played on multiple teams. Beyond his athletic achievement, Arthur had a passion for writing poetry, reflecting his creative and expressive spirit. Arthur McWhite was not only known for his warm-hearted nature, but also for his unwavering commitment to others. He prioritized the well-being of family and friends, always placing their needs above his own. His mantras, if I can help someone along the way, epitomized his life philosophy. Arthur leaves behind a legacy of love, of love and compassion. He is survived by his devoted and loving parents, Mother N.L. W. McWhite and Father Arthur McWhite Sr. His children, son Elijah Maxwell McWhite of Glastonbury, Connecticut, and Leah Emily B. McWhite, Stockbridge, Georgia, will forever cherish the memories of their caring father. Arthur is also survived by his brother, Tony Lamar McWhite, of Windsor, Connecticut, and he held a special place in his heart for Xavier Chaplin as a father figure. Additionally, he leaves behind his girlfriend, Cassandra Parkman, and a host of family and friends who were always there for him. Arthur Renard, Nard McWhite Jr. will be deeply missed, not only for the warmth he shared, but also for the time and talents he generously bestowed upon others. His memory will forever live on in the heart of those who were fortunate enough to know him. May he rest in eternal peace. God bless.
Amen. We have heard this beautiful eulogy, and my cousin Annelle said that she wrote it. What a beautiful tribute to her son, Arthur. Amen. Now we're at the part of the program where some of you who had special relationships, special time with Arthur Jr. can share your memories, so as to take what we've heard, just read, and bring it into a lively expression. And so if there is anyone here at this time who would like to share memories of Arthur, commonly known as Narda Art, will you please come share with us? Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
As many of you all just heard, my father was what we humans like to call a jack of many trades. Mm-hmm. From a D1 athlete to a bowling champion to a man of greatness. Mm. My father taught me, if anything, how to appreciate anything and everything, not just people, but situations and time and,
my goodness.
And just everything that we go through. So if you take anything from today, just take the time to appreciate everyone around you.
Amen. Beautiful, beautiful. Heartfelt. Amen, amen. Anybody else? Now, everybody couldn't come down from, at, our grandparents would say, up north, who knew him.
Amen.
But I'm sure there are stories ringing around, not only in one city, but in many cities, where he has touched the lives of individuals. And what a legacy you have. What a legacy you have to continue to tell the story. Is there anyone else? All right, sir. I thought you were going to do it while you were up. Oh. Okay.
Hello again. I'm Tony McWhite, Arthur's big brother. He's my little brother. I always say, me and my little brother, you know, when I was 7 years old, my mother brought him into the world. He like crawled around and she said, look at the little baby. Isn't the baby nice? Look at the little baby. And I was like, yeah, look at the little baby. I like the little baby. And she says, you the little baby's brother, you gonna be the big brother. And I'm like, okay, I'm gonna be the big brother, I'm a big brother. So that was cool and fine and everything. And you know, as time went on, you know, the little brother was getting all the attention. You know? It's like, I like to watch the Wildlife Channel, and you know, that when mother bird go flying away to get food, the big bird pushed the little bird out so he can have some food, all the food when he get back. But you know, my mother taught me, she said, you're not gonna do that to your little brother. What you gonna do, you're gonna feed him and lead him. And that's what I had to do. You know, when he was 2 years old, he was born on St. Patrick's Day, the Green Irish Day. And on his second birthday, my mother brought him a green cake, invited a lot of little kids over. And for some reason, she sat the cake on a hasset. And I had my favorite yellow pants on. For some reason, I sat in that cake. And it didn't destroy the party, because all the kids still ate that cake. But it messed up my yellow pants. But, you know, it brought to my attention, you know, that's my little brother. I love him. I got to always look out for him. And I'm still trying to wrap my head around it, but I know he's going to a better place, you know. He's on the other side. You know, his body is here, but his spirit has moved on. And I pray to my high power, my God, to hold him in his arms and to cherish him and hold my little brother and take care of him until I can see him again. And I know I'm going to see him again. And I'm just glad to be up here to, you know, to talk good about him, you know. But he departed us, and I love him. I'm always love him. I'm going to see him again, little brother. That's all.
Amen. 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 Right. Amen. I want to do something I've never done before. At a funeral service, many of the family members who are in Georgia don't know some of the family members from Connecticut. So I know you are a brother. Does Arthur have any other children here? Okay, no more children here. I know one of my favorite cousins, his mother, she was like a big sister to me when I was growing up. They live right there and we live right down the road. So we spent a lot of time together. Any other blood relative who's here, so we can just, those in Georgia, we can say, well, is that you, Grace May?
Uh-huh.
Oh, yes, I know that voice. I know that voice. She was like a big sister to me, too. Oh, my goodness. Anybody else? There.
I'm Charles, better known as Champ. My mother was the oldest of Grace May and Ruth.
Oh, my goodness, you're Ruth, Charles? Oh, I mean, yeah. Oh, yes, Ruth.
Only
like this and we're so formal. But we always need to go for the relationship.
Amen.
To talk about what we know and how we feel. And so right now we're about to move on to the music selection. And after that, God's willing, his word will come forth through me.
To it without me. You gotta tell it for yourself.
And we see evidence of that in the obituary. Words are very important. Words set the tone for certain events. Yes. But there's nothing like God's word.
Absolutely.
To set the tone. And so this afternoon, to my dear family, and for those of you who may be wondering, well, how in the world did she get connected? Simply, Annelle's daddy, Uncle Columbus, was my granddaddy's uncle. They were only 2 years apart. And I was raised in my granddaddy's house. And so over the years, I had that connection with the Whitehead family and have been a part of this body. I grew up in this church and, of course, moved away. But there is that connection. And so I asked God to give me the words for this afternoon. And amazingly, he gave me a strange message, Edwin. That's another cousin over there. And another cousin over there. He gave me a strange message. He said, talk about last words. Yes. In case you don't know it, the word eulogy, when translated, means last words. Mm-hmm. Last good words. And so I started going through the Bible looking at last good words in certain books of the Bible. Mm-hmm. And as I did, I could pinpoint the traits that I read about Nard in his obituary. Loving, compassionate, mm-hmm. athletic, a champion for others, especially a champion for others with challenges. And so one of the verses that came to me was to go to Deuteronomy, chapter 34, the last verse in the Old Testament, in the law books, not the Old Testament, in the law books. And this is what is in this passage, Deuteronomy chapter 34, verses 10 through 12. And I just thank God for his word. I love his word. I love the power of his word. And this is what Moses wrote. Since then, this is written about Moses, I'm sorry. Since then, no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, who did all those signs and wonders the Lord sent him to do in Egypt, to Pharaoh and to all his officials and to his whole land. But no one has ever shown the mighty power or performed the awesome deeds that Moses did in the sight of all Israel. What I thought about was, yes, Moses was an extraordinary man of God. But like Moses, Renard was exceptional too. He excelled in reaching out to people. He excelled in athletics. He excelled in going beyond the call of duty to make a change in the world that he wanted to see. I'm going to put a pin there because a lot of us live our lives every day talking about what the world needs to be like. Well, the best way to make the world become what we want it to be is for us to be it. We are to be the change that we want to see in the world. And I saw this out of his life. And then I went down to Psalm 150, verse 6, and it says, let everything that has breath praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Every believer is reminded to praise God for his goodness. Nard used his God-given gifts to lift up the spirits of others. And because he did, we ought to praise God for God's divine power. But we also need to praise God for what he does through the lives of those people we come in contact with him. I'm sure his parents and his cousins and relatives over the years have heard all these great testimonies about his exceptional abilities. But I do want you to know that Nard didn't do that all on his own. And as believers in Christ, we don't excel and do all that we are to do on our own. And instead of going down to the end of this next verse, I'm going to just go to some words Jesus used right at the end of his ministry. that's Acts chapter 1, verse 8. And this is what he said, church. But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will bear witnesses for me in Jerusalem and throughout all Judea and Samaria and even in the farthest corners of the world. You have a testimony.
Yes.
You have power.
Yes.
You have something in you that God has given.
Yes.
Do not allow it to lie dormant. Do not walk around every day complaining and watching the news and talking about everything that's going wrong. Use your power.
Yes.
Because when Jesus gave these last words, he said, but you shall receive power. And the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, some of us love to say. We don't like saying Holy Ghost. We get a little scared of that word. The Holy Spirit has come upon you.
Yes.
And when I think about Nart's life, I see him using the power that was in his body to run, to play sports, and to do his art. I see a likeness of this in his life. And then I went down to the end of the Bible. Way over there in the book of Revelation. Revelation 22, verses 20 through 21. When I thought about last words, the eulogy in these books, this is what John, the Revelator, wrote. He who gives this testimony says, yes, I'm coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
Yes.
The grace of the Lord Jesus be with you. I want to repeat that for every one of us in here.
Amen.
That is the end of the written Bible as we know it.
Yes.
Revelation chapter 22, verses 20 and 21. Yes, I'm coming soon. That's Jesus talking. Yes, I'm coming soon. Amen. Amen, me. So be it. That is the truth. Verily, 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 I say unto you. And then John writes, come, Lord Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
How many of us are ready today to say, come, Lord Jesus?
Yeah.
Because the Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, he shall descend, and the angel will blow the trumpet. And the dead in Christ will rise first.
Yeah.
And those of us who may be left on this earth when he comes back, we will rise up to be with them in the air.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to tell you there's a pre-registration form.
Yeah.
The pre-registration form is, Lord Jesus, I confess you with my mouth.
Yeah.
Right. I believe in my heart that you have raised Jesus from the dead.
Yeah.
I trust you, God, to know that I cannot do this on my own. And so when John the Revelator finished the books, the last words in the entire Bible, he wrote it for us, you all. He wrote it for us because he knew we would be in places like this. We would be in funerals for people like Nard. That will cause us to think about our death, will cause us to think about what is it going to be like when I die.
Yeah.
It is time to read these last words before the last words will be spoken. Because the ultimate last words that will be spoken will either be, well done, my good and faithful servant.
Yeah.
Come on up. Come on up. You've been faithful over a few things.
Yeah.
Now I want you to see how much I got for you. I want to see how many mansions I've prepared for you. I want you to see that because you believed in these words, in my word, that you're ready. Not for the end of your life, but as I said in the beginning, this is really the beginning of your life. So as we leave this service today, I want us to be sure we know he's coming.
Yeah.
He's coming soon.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
So be it.
Amen.
Verily, verily, I say unto you, Jesus is coming soon. And I want to add one final point. The reason he can have the last word or the last words is because of what he did in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1. It all belongs to him. In the beginning, God created the heaven and earth. Yeah. So everything from Genesis 1, 1 to Revelation 22, verses, chapter 22, verses 20 and 21, God said, he meant it, and we better get in line. Amen. 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 Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed. Be blessed.
Blessings of the Lord. The following war arrangement has been sent to the